All right. Well, welcome back to our class on Jewish culture. We're making the shift from verbal culture to something else. As you recall, our previous sessions were on the Torah and the Talmud and even modern Jewish literature, which are very word-focused. Obviously, they're stories, novels, poetry. But now we're getting into the visual, the auditory, experiential culture, you might call it. Our first session today is on a middle ground between the writing and the experiential. It's performance, where you have a script, so there's still words. We'll get into music and art, which are really nonverbal expressions in most cases. Of course, you have lyrics for songs, but also melodies, and obviously art is visual, be it sculpture or painting. We'll do that the following session in a couple of weeks. But in whatever we're doing today, if we're talking about movies or we're talking about theater as live theater or we're talking about television, it's all a variety of acting Jewish or acting about Judaism. And it's somewhat similar to our exploration of modern Jewish literature, where we had to ask the question, what's Jewish about this? And what makes it Jewish literature or Jewish literature and American literature if it can be cross-categorized in multiple ways? And in each of these areas we're going to be talking about, theater, movies, and television, there's a lot one could talk about in terms of how Jewish identity is expressed there, the Jewish roots of some of the pieces of these, the Jewish biographies of people who helped to develop them. But we're only going to scratch the surface because you could do, you know, graduate level study on any one of those. So we're not going to deal with everything. But one of the interesting things I find in thinking about movies particularly, but also theater to some extent, and certainly television as well, is that it's a different kind of choice than when you're writing. Because when you're writing, you're describing things. And how you use language to paint the picture is going to be different than how you use pictures to paint the picture. And what imagery you use, what lighting, what colors, what where the frame is, what's left out of the frame. You know, it's a very different medium than describing. I was really struck when I read the wonderful novel, All the Light We Cannot See, by, I'm forgetting his name, Anthony Doerr, I think his name is, where the protagonist in a main part of the book is deaf. And so you get, she's blind. So you get no descriptions of anything visual. You get what things feel like, you get what she's hearing, but you don't, it doesn't, he does a great job of putting you in her shoes, so to speak, by not describing anything visual. And even though it's a third person narrative, it's from her perspective in those scenes. So that's something a movie doesn't do, but a movie can give it to you from one character's perspective and you see what you see, but you don't see what's left off camera. So anyways, it's part of the shift in the medium. It's going to affect a little bit of how we understand what it means to make someone Jewish. For example, in a novel, you could say, the character could say, I'm Jewish, or you know, or someone says something to them in Yiddish and you make the identification. How do you mark them as Jewish in a movie? You could do a similar kind of, you know, explicit exposition, or you could have them attending a synagogue service, or you could have them lighting a Hanukkah candle. There's all kinds of visuals that you could do as cues that you couldn't necessarily do purely visually in a book. Obviously, in a graphic novel, you could do that. It's also sort of in the middle ground between writing and visual art. So some general themes that I think come out of the study of Jewish performance, we put it that way, that apply to all three of these genres. So one example is, how do you consider the characters? Does what make this into a Jewish movie or a Jewish television show, or even a Jewish episode of a general television show, is it the characters? Are the characters Jewish themselves in some explicit way, or is it how a certain character relates to Jewish characters or Jewish figures? So as one example, there's a character in the TV show Grey's Anatomy, who's Dr. Christina Yang, who's Chinese, played by a wonderful actress, but Michelle Yu, I think her name is?
No, Sandra Oh.
Oh, thank you.
I
made the wrong connection. Yes, Sandra Oh is the actress, but her character is Jewish. Because when her father died, her mother married someone Jewish and she converted and was raised Jewish. It comes out as sort of a surprise at an early episode of the series because one doesn't expect someone who looks Chinese to have lived Jewish experience. Of course, we know now that that's absolutely not uncommon. It does happen in all varieties of ethnicities being raised as part of the Jewish family, broadly considered. But they had to make an explicit statement about it because it couldn't, it had that sort of shock factor to it by design. What if all the characters are Jewish in a movie? Like, consider an Israeli film where if it's set in Israel, they're speaking Hebrew, they're, you know, living comfortably in the mainstream Jewish society. You'd assume they're all Jewish. What if they never light a Hanukkah candle or go to a certain synagogue service? Or does it matter if they're Jewish, if they're all Jewish in a film? Often without the contrast of Jewish to not Jewish, what does the Jewishness mean for a character in a particular piece? So that's one lens through which to think about this, is the characters. The second is what might define it as Jewish could be the plot or the setting. You know, what's happening? What's the action? What's the content? Or what are the scenes that it's drawing? Again, if it's set in a synagogue, if it's set lighting Hanukkah candles, that's going to give you some clues or some information or some sort of a message that it's trying to convey. We could ask, are there Jewish dramatic themes that would be separate from a Jewish character or a Jewish setting? You know, could you say a film kind of feels Jewish even if you don't define the characters as Jewish? As one example, Mel Brooks did a Western called Blazing Saddles. And in many ways, it feels like a very Jewish film because Mel Brooks has his shtick that's involved. I'll let you see one of the scenes at the end. But none of the characters, as far as I know, are identified as Jewish, even Lili von Stupp. It's what makes it a Jewish film? Is it the fact that Brooks himself is Jewish, or is it there's something about the way the stories are told, or the rhetoric, or the jokes back and forth? I guess Harvey Korman is Jewish, who is in that film. But again, it's not the core characters, and it's not the actor is Jewish, but again, the character is not played as Jewish. If the actors are Jewish, maybe that defines it as Jewish in some way. Do they bring something Jewish to their performance in their mannerisms or style, or do we now become sort of essentialists, saying that, well, there's something Jews look like or something Jews act like, and therefore that actor is acting Jewish? I mean, it begins to feel sort of distasteful in the genetic investigation there. If a Jewish character is playing a Jewish actor is playing a non-Jewish character, does that make the character, you know, what's the dynamic there? Or is that just a person playing a person and they're inhabiting the role, you know? What about non-Jewish actors playing Jewish characters? This became a bit controversial earlier this Jewish year, I think it was late in 2021, where Sarah Silverman complained about actors doing what she called Jew face, which is non-Jewish actors playing Jewish characters. Think of, for example, The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel, which some people have watched on Netflix. The main actress in that, Rachel Brosnahan, is not Jewish. She grew up in Highland Park, but she's not Jewish. But she's playing this Jewish character. I looked up the cast for TV's The Goldbergs, which is set in the 1980s, and most of the Goldberg family is not Jewish. In fact, one of the actors' last names is Gentile. Or it's Gentile because it's Italian, but it's it's just ironic that in this show called The Goldbergs about this Jewish family, one of the actors is in fact not Jewish at all. Or if you've seen the movie A Price Above Rubies, which is about an ultra-Orthodox Jewish woman who wants to leave and has challenges getting out and so on. It's a really wonderful movie, but the woman is played by Renee Zellweger, who herself is not Jewish. But she's inhabiting this ultra-Orthodox Jewish woman character in a very compelling way. Of course, we know Alec Guinness played King Faisal in Lawrence of Arabia, and blackface is an old and terrible tradition. So people have played outside of their identities, and we're even hearing now about gay characters being played by straight actors and trans characters being played by non-trans actors and all these complexities of identity and acting. But if we're thinking about the Jewishness of a film or a character, is it affected by the identity of the actor who's inhabiting that character? Or can they play Jewish and that's fine? And can a Jewish actor play non-Jewish? A lot of Jews have played Italians, for example, through history. I mean, Sal Mineo changed his name to something. He was Jewish, but he played Italian in a lot of his films. Another question you can ask is about the writer and the director. Again, I mentioned Mel Brooks with Blazing Saddles. Does that make it Jewish? Or what about non-Jews who direct very Jewish movies? For example, the movie Fiddler on the Roof, right? You want to think quintessential Jewish movie? You think Fiddler on the Roof? The director is Norman Jewison, who despite his name is not Jewish. He was often, you know, called Jewish growing up because of the name, but he actually is not Jewish at all. He also directed Jesus Christ Superstar, so maybe that was, you know, the other side of the ledger for him. But he, you know, again, does that make the film not Jewish because the director wasn't Jewish, or did he do a good enough job inhabiting the script and the characters and the setting and the drama? And, you know, that's the other side of it. And then you could even ask, if there are Jews explicitly presented, how are they being presented? Are they exotic, like the ultra-Orthodox in the Netflix drama Unorthodox, or the documentary One of Us, or in A Price of Rubies? You know, think of the Amish in Witness, you know, who are this exotic weirdo community. And again, they chose there aren't that many Amish actors, right? Right, maybe ex-Amish, you know, who become actors. You know, the people who played these parts are Hollywood actors fitting into that exotic role. So is that how Jews are presented in this story? Are they these exotic, odd sort of cult community? Or are they presented as sort of normal but kind of eccentric? You know, I think about Jewish characters on the TV sitcom The Big Bang Theory or The Nanny, you know, where they're Jewish, and what marks them as Jewish is a particular quirky style of personality or whatever. Or maybe sometimes they're mentioned as Jewish in passing and it doesn't really affect their character development at all. It's just part of who they are and it's in the background. And unless it comes to the fore in a Christmas time episode or something, it really is not mentioned or highlighted. You know, in that I think about like Ross and Monica Geller in Friends, where their name is Geller. At one point, Ross decides he really needs to get his son to celebrate Hanukkah, so he makes a big deal out of it. But they really almost never mention their Jewishness through the whole episode. There's nothing to do with dietary laws, nothing to do with holiday celebrations. They all do Christmas, like that. There's no barrier. So it really is a very different, you know, dynamic when the Jewishness is just in the background. And then you can even ask the question, do they even label the characters Jewish at all? But people assume they're Jewish. So this happened with the show Seinfeld for a long time, where people assumed that some of the characters must have been Jewish by the way they were acting, and only some of them actually had it explicitly referenced in a biography, where Jerry Seinfeld is explicitly referenced as Jewish as his character, as he is personally, and Cosmo Kramer, his neighbor, comes out as Jewish at one point, but George Costanza has the name Costanza, and his parents, even though his dad, Jerry Stiller, is a very Jewish actor and, you know, and has that whole personality. But they do Festivus, that's right. They don't do Christmas or Hanukkah, they do Festivus instead. And Elaine Benes also is highlighted as not being Jewish in one episode. But again, people wonder, you know, what is that all about? So this is one of those cases where they don't label them. And the other example I think of is Paul Reiser in Mad About You, if you remember that show from the 1990s, where he was married to this blonde woman, Helen Hunt, and they never really referenced his identity, but again, he played Jewish, like the acting, the style, the speaking, whatever, felt very Jewish if you're watching for that, you know, Ashkenazi style personality. And they clearly had the culture clash model of, you know, the blonde wife and then her parents versus his parents. She was very WASPy and his parents were very sort of New York Jewish. And so that's where it sort of played to it, but they never really highlighted the ethnic identities or got into that material. And they might've actually been burned by an episode that took place in the 1970s. In 1972 to 73, CBS came out with a sitcom called Bridget Loves Bernie. And it was about an explicitly interfaith family where they used the interfaithness of the family to create the sort of tension and conflict in the story, where he was sort of a working class, I think, cab driver, and she was from a more upper class Irish Catholic family. But then they had to, you know, figure out how are they going to get married and where they're going to live. And they have scenes, episodes with a rabbi and episodes with a priest, and then the family in-laws meet each other. But they were really getting into this issue, but they were presenting it as this is a loving couple who loves each other and they're trying to make it work. And the Jewish community lost its marbles over this show in 1972, because it was presenting intermarriage as no big deal. And even if it wasn't a big deal for people who were actually getting intermarried, it was a big deal for the organized Jewish community who wanted nothing to do with any kind of positive representation of it. I mean, there were calls for boycotts and all kinds of, so CBS canceled the show. It wasn't worth the stress. But you can look up Bridget Loves Bernie, and I don't know if it was a great show or not, but the controversy was interesting, and so maybe people decided rather than get into the tension of that, we'll just sort of hide the religion stuff and not talk about it as much. But if you fast forward 10 or 15 years from there, you have a show like, I'm blanking now on the show because I've watched so many shows and movies in the last 2 days. The sort of groundbreaking show with the two male gay characters on it, Will and Grace, that was it, Will and Grace, where Grace in that show is Grace Adler, who's explicitly Jewish. But again, it's no barrier to her friendship with other people and who she dates, but it's part of her biography, but doesn't create the same kind of barriers that 30 years ago it would have for Bridget and Bernie. Anyways, so this is sort of an overview of some of the issues that come out when you're dealing with what makes a Jewish play, what makes a Jewish a movie or a Jewish sitcom or TV show. So thinking first about the stage theater, the roots of Jewish theater do not go back to the ancient world, where the Greeks do have a tradition going back to the ancient world in Europe. But definitely by the Middle Ages, there were examples of Jewish plays. They were called Purim spiels. Purim is the holiday we're celebrating this week, actually. And a spiel means a play or a story. Like when someone says, what's your spiel? It's like, what's your story? And a Purim spiel was a retelling of the Purim narrative, but often set in contemporary times, often mocking people whom you would recognize right away, even the rabbi, even the king or the duke of the area. So it was sort of a carnival Mardi Gras opportunity to break the boundaries and, you know, make fun of the pieties. And people would dress up in costumes. And actually, we have records in the Middle Ages of rabbis saying, these are terrible things and no one should ever do them again, and I banned them. And people kept doing them because they were fun. So the Purim spiel goes back a long time. But again, it's a very limited, episodic, you know, holiday-focused event. The real birth of modern Yiddish Jewish theater is the Yiddish theater, which appears in the late 19th century. The first show we know of was in Romania in 1876, founded by Avraham Goldfaden, and then it moves to New York City by 1882, along with all those Eastern European Jews who are moving to New York City. They bring this idea of Yiddish theater with them. And some of it is very highfalutin, intellectual. They translate Shakespeare into Yiddish. You know, King Lear works really well because it has an older parent complaining about an ungrateful child. Like, you know, doesn't say she doesn't call, she doesn't write, but it's a similar kind of joke, you know. Sharper than a serpent's tooth it is to have a thankless child. Although I think in the Yiddish King Lear, they reconcile at the end as sort of a happy ending, because it did tend to the melodramatic in those days. And there was, of course, mass theater available as well, because remember that the Yiddish speaking audience often was working class. They were not intellectuals. They did not have college degrees. And many of them were not even necessarily literate in Hebrew. They knew the letters and they spoke Yiddish, so they could read the Yiddish, you know, advertisements and so on, and in the newspapers, announcements and reviews, but they weren't reading Hebrew. So a Hebrew theater wouldn't have worked, but a Yiddish language theater worked, and it was speaking their language, literally, and they could connect with it. It became a major Jewish cultural expression for 60 years until the Holocaust wiped out the large number of Jewish Yiddish speakers. There still were Yiddish theaters that survived to some extent. There is one in Israel. I think even today, I found out just recently there's one in Australia because they've managed to maintain a Yiddish-speaking culture there more so than in other places. But, you know, at the time, it was a core way to express your Jewishness, not in the synagogue, but through popular culture on the stage. It also becomes the basis for vaudeville performers, for musical theater, and there was even a flowering version of Soviet-sponsored Yiddish culture in the Soviet Union in the 1920s, because they saw it as a counterpoint to Zionism in Hebrew. They would sponsor socialist Yiddish culture, and it thrived in the 20s before Stalin smashed it in the 30s and certainly in the 50s. So I'm gonna play for you a short clip from a documentary about the Yiddish theater.
Before the Broadway musical set up home near Times Square in the early 20th century, there was a lively theatre that thrived downtown on the Lower East Side, where Yiddishkeit, meaning all things Jewish, took centre stage. There, Russian immigrants like Boris Tomaszewski and his wife Bessie pioneered a novel form of musical theatre which spoke to the multitude of newcomers fresh off the boat, the Yiddish theater.
There is a huge connection between Broadway and the American Yiddish theater. People don't get that anymore about how powerful Yiddishkeit was in the foundation of Broadway, and that the direction of Yiddishkeit was twofold. It was to amuse, but it was also to instruct, and that the theater could be used ultimately as a medium for showing people on stage how certain situations in life might play out, and hopefully offering them the opportunity to learn from the examples that they saw on stage.
I was a protege of the great Boris Tomaszewski.
Oh.
Yes. Yes. He taught me everything I know. I'll never forget. He turned to me on his deathbed and said, Maxilla, alle Menschen müssen machen. Heiden took a gas and gas and pissing pipikachen.
What does that mean?
Who knows? I don't speak Yiddish. Strangely enough, neither did he.
So it's just a little, you know, flavor, a geschmack of the Yiddish theater. But the claim is made, and I think justifiably so, that many of the roots of Broadway were found in this Yiddish theater experience. And it continues into the 20s, 30s, 50s, 60s. If you look at all the major songwriters, almost all of them, other than Cole Porter, were Jewish. And Cole Porter was once asked how he planned to be successful in Broadway, and he said, well, I'll just write Jewish.
Once upon a time, King Arthur wanted to take his knights on a quest to do a musical on Broadway, but this was a very, very bad idea, and I'm going to tell you why. In any great adventure, if you don't want to lose, victory depends upon the people that you choose.
So listen, Arthur, darling, closely to this news. You won't succeed on Broadway if you don't have any Jews.
You may have the finest sets, fill the stage with penthouse pets. You may have the loveliest costumes and best shoes. You may dance and you may sing, but I'm sorry, Arthur King, you'll hear no cheers, just lots and lots of boos. You may have butch men by the score whom the audience adore. You may even have some animals from zoos. Though you've poles and krauts instead, you may have unleavened bread, but I tell you, you are dead if you don't have any Jews.
It's not funny unless it's true. And people only laugh because it's true.
Rodgers and Hammerstein, you can name off all the Broadway composers. Jerry Herman, Irving Berlin. Everybody on Broadway except Cole Porter.
Sheldon Harnick and Jerry Bach. George Gershwin, Steve Sondheim. I'm trying to think if there was anybody not Jewish.
My husband, Adolph Green, and his wonderful partner, Betty Comden, and of course, Lenny Bernstein. Why were they, so many of them, Jewish?
There simply must be, Arthur, trust me, simply must be Jews.
That you look at all those major songwriters, they all were Jewish and had interesting connections to their roots. In fact, there's one speculation. I'm not sure this is justifiable or not. But people make a connection between the melody and the Gershwin song, It Ain't Necessarily So, and the traditional blessing on the taking out of the Torah. So it ain't necessarily so. And then for the blessing as you remove the Torah is Baruch Adonai Mevarach L'olam Ba'ed. So you're sort of doing a similar up and down. I'm not sure about that. And the other big variable is, I don't know if the Gershwins ever went to synagogue. Like, you know? So you can't just assume because they're Jewish, then they're listening to this this melody in synagogue. That's one of the problems in being the Jewish detective with this stuff. But certainly, I'll give you one other sort of amusing example. If you've ever seen the musical Cabaret, there's a wonderful, chilling number called The World Belongs to Me, where people start singing this song and it's very sort of uplifting, and then you realize it's a Nazi hymn and they all start saluting and wearing the banners and stuff, and it sort of sucks you in. But when this the musical first and then the movie came out, people were outraged and how dare you put this Nazi hymn on stage, and And they pointed out, A, this is in English. Like, this isn't a Nazi song. We wrote it for the musical. And secondly, the songwriters are Jewish. Like, what do you think we're doing? But ironically, some neo-Nazis have picked up the song because they see it as sort of this, you know, this anthem. And then they find out the writers are Jewish, and they have to drop it. They could go back and do Springtime for Hitler, but they'd have to edit that one too, right? Okay, so now let's make the shift from theater to movies, because here you have, you know, theater goes back a long way. Movies are a 20th century invention, more or less. I mean, the technology, I think, is at the very end of the 19th, but it's not commercialized until the 20th century. And it's a famous or infamous canard that the Jewish people built Hollywood. Or maybe better to say, some Jewish people were instrumental in the foundation of Hollywood. That's anthropology, right? That's history. If you said the Jews run Hollywood, now you sound like a conspiracy theorist, okay? So make a distinction between some Jews did things in Hollywood and the Jews run Hollywood. Certainly there were some writers and actors, you know, and some actors with name changes, like Edward G. Robinson was originally Goldberg and made it his middle initial so that he could play in Peoria, so to speak. But we do know that many of the studio heads who sort of fostered the films and produced them and had the vision to create them, like the Warner Brothers, Sam Goldwyn and Louis B. Mayer, which became Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, Carl Lemmel, who founded Universal, Adolf Zukor, who founded Paramount, Marcus Lowe, think of the Lowe's Theaters, the AMC Theaters. And many of them actually got into the movies as showing other people's movies and realized they could make it themselves. And then they would have a closed circuit, you know, of expenses there. It was also a new industry. Some of them made their money elsewhere in furs or clothing or other industries, and then decided they wanted to go into something else. And they weren't tied to old industries or had a lot of capital sunk into a big factory. They had something more portable, and so they could move to a new industry. And they knew that movies had a mass appeal, especially with this huge immigrant population. These were relatively cheap entertainments. This was not the opera. It was not the symphony. There was no TV. There was, you know, no radio, at least in the early phase. So this became an opportunity for them. And don't forget, there was no language barrier to a movie when it was just a movie, right? They call them talkies when they had sound. But they were originally movies because they were moving pictures, and you have the slides coming in every now and then, but most of it is what you're seeing presented as a visual. And why did they move to Los Angeles in Southern California? It wasn't just to get away from the Northeast industrialists. Remember, in the 1910s, you had to shoot movies outside, and you needed light and sun. And there were just more days of light and sun and temperate weather in Southern California than there were in Washington, D.C. or New York. So it just made it more feasible to do it in those days. And as we moved from the movies to the talkies, that marks a very interesting moment in film history. Because you may remember the very first talking film is a very Jewish film. It's the Al Jolson's The Jazz Singer. Now, Jolson was famous as a vaudeville performer, so the name was attractive. But the film they made is amazingly a very Jewish story about a cantor's son who doesn't want to sing Kol Nidre on Yom Kippur, and then becomes a famous singer. He gets his big break singing in a restaurant place where he's eating bacon and eggs some morning, and they make it explicit, like you see the bacon and eggs on the plate. And he gets his break, he begins touring and performing. He winds up able to perform in New York City in his big break, but the opening night is on Kol Nidre, and his father is ill. And his father had told him to get out of the house because how dare you sing that American jazz music. But now he comes home and he sings Kol Nidre before his father dies, and his father hears him, and it's beautiful. And then they just postpone the opening night to the next night, and he opens, you know, the next night, and everything's great. Except he opens in blackface singing Mammy, which we have to grapple with. But the point of the story is, why is this such a Jewish movie that was used for the first talking movie? This is a real gamble. Why make it so Jewish? Well, you have to remember again, in 1927, you've had this huge wave of immigration coming from the 1880s to the 1920s, not just Jews, but Italians and Irish and all kinds of other peoples. They're all dealing with this battle of the old world versus the new, of tradition versus modernity, of American culture versus old world. So, and the fact that Kol Nidre is a beautiful melody just helps, you know, to demonstrate the power of the medium. So I'm going to play for you a short clip from the movie. This is sort of in the middle where Jolson has been starting to become a success, but he goes to see a concert that brings him back to his roots. See how that scene of hearing the cantor sing, and then the cantor is singing a Yiddish song, but then he says Yitzgadal v'Yitzgadash, which is part of the beginning of the Kaddish, and it brings him back to his father singing in the synagogue, and it's all overlaid in who he is. And again, you know, with this play in Peoria, well, it played because it was that old versus new dynamic, or religion and secular, whatever, and the music was just very powerful, even if it was not, you know, what you might have imagined. So, general, though, the American Jewish filmmakers did not emphasize Jewishness in their films. In fact, it was generally the opposite. They focused on the American dream as a generic thing. They did a song. They did a movie about Christmas that made it about snow called White Christmas. Yeah. They turned Easter into a parade instead of about the resurrection. Like they, you know, they did have some religious films, too, of course. But primarily their focus was not on Judaism or Jewishness or it was Americanness and Americanism. And they de-emphasized their Jewishness so much so that when a film came out after World War II that was an expose of anti-Semitism called Gentleman's Agreement with Gregory Peck playing a reporter who decides to claim that he's Jewish and see what happens. And so he investigates the phenomenon. When this film was about to come out, the studio heads were appalled. They didn't want to highlight the fact that all these parts of American life were anti-Semitic. So they actually called the filmmakers in and said, no. We know how to handle this. Don't put it out this way. You got to change the film and don't do it. So the filmmaker actually went back and wrote a new scene for the end of the film where the Gregory Peck character is about to publish his expose and all these newspaper executives call him in and say, no, we know how to handle this. You don't need to do that. So he actually sort of exposed that meeting, but their style was, you know, back room negotiations, you know, meet with the power broker. Don't make a public stink about it. That was not their style at all. In fact, their desire to avoid public stinks led to one of the two major crises that the studios faced. There were a couple of major scandals in the 1920s with a murder and a rape and some other issues with some of their major stars. And there began to be boycotts talked about because of the content of the films. If you look at some of the films that were made in the 1920s, Scarface and some others that were very violent and sometimes sexually explicit in some ways that we would be surprised at now. These are what are called pre-code films, because beginning in the 1930s, they created a code for filmmaking, sometimes called the Hays Code, after the Episcopal official who ran it. They decided to self-censor and to not include anything that could be construed as objectionable. So you never saw people kissing heavily, no two people in bed, you never saw somebody swear, no blasphemy, no miscegenation was one of their rules, no homosexuality, that was under the category of sexual perversion. You couldn't see someone like commit a crime and get away with it. The criminal always had to like die in the end. You couldn't glorify that. And the joke about the Hays Code was that it was Catholics telling Jews how to make movies for Protestants because they spoke for America. But the code was in effect from 1930 until 1968. So a long period of time. And then when the code broke down, then you get all kinds of, you know, very interesting, creative, radical movies that are changing the face of movies. So that was one crisis they avoided by, again, accommodating and acquiescing. They restricted their artistic freedom to be able to continue to make movies and make money. The other major crisis they faced was in the 1940s, and that was the investigation of communism in Hollywood. The House Un-American Activities Committee began to hold hearings investigating socialism and communism in Hollywood specifically. Were their messages secretly put into films? I mean, the fact that they had made a few films sympathetic to the Soviet Union during the war when they were our ally, all of a sudden became turned around on the screenwriters and the directors who had done so. Now, some of them had been Communist Party members, which was a legal thing to do at the time, but some of them had not been. They were just sort of guilt by association, and it was a really terrible period. People were informing on each other, or if you didn't inform, then you could be blacklisted and not get work anymore. And so that was a real crisis. And again, the studio heads threw everybody under the bus. They did not protect anybody, and they followed a blacklist, a sort of self-imposed blacklist, to not hire people who had communist associations. And it created a lot of challenges for a lot of people. So I do want to play a few clips of Jewish films that are often understood as Jewish films. The first one is from 1971. This is Fiddler on the Roof. I want to play just the beginning of the film a little bit, and then we'll also look at the end. But I want you to think, and we'll actually open up and talk about this, watching the first scene of the film, which is this number tradition that you're probably familiar with, is this expressing the Jewish identity of most of the Jews watching this film? Or is it expressing something else? What is it trying to tell you about what being Jewish is by this opening scene?
And how do we keep our balance? That I can tell you in one word. Tradition!
Tradition! Tradition!
Because of our traditions, we've kept our balance for many, many years. Here in Anatevka, we have traditions for everything. How to sleep, how to eat, how to work, how to wear clothes. For instance, we always keep our heads covered and always wear a little prayer shawl. This shows our constant devotion to God. You may ask, how did this tradition get started? I'll tell you. I don't know. But it's a tradition. And because of our traditions, Every one of us knows who he is and what God expects him to do.
Who day and night must scramble for a living, feed a wife and children, say his daily prayers, and who has a right as master of the house to have the final word at home? The papa! The papa! Permission! The papa! The papa! Permission! Who must know the way to make a proper home? A quiet home, a kosher home. Who must raise a family and run the home? So Papa's free to read the holy book. The mama, the mama. Tradition, the mama, the mama. Tradition. I started Hebrew school, at 10 I learned a trade. I hear they picked a bride for me, I hope she's pretty.
And who does Mama teach? The men and tend and fix, preparing her to marry whoever Papa picks. The daughters, the daughters.
Tradition.
And in the circle of our little village, we've always had our special types. For instance, Yenta the matchmaker.
For your girl.
Reb Nachum the beggar. And most important of all, our beloved rabbi.
Rabbi, may I ask you a question?
Certainly, Leibish.
Is there a proper blessing for the Tsar?
A blessing for the Tsar, of course. May God bless and keep the Tsar far away from us.
A much bigger circle. We don't bother them, and so far, they don't bother us.
What do you see in that presentation about what being Jewish is? Like, if someone came into the theater and had never met a Jewish person in their life, what would they think Jews are all about? Go ahead.
They have all sorts of rules. They think that they were all religious, which my family would be really upset about, because they were in Russia, in Belarus, all secular.
Right.
Yeah, I think that's probably true for my great-grandfather, who was secular. Although I know that my great-grandfather came here.
Right.
Well, it looks like a tradition. I mean, it's a word, but a traditional community that you see in different non-urban places.
Right. So you notice it's.
We all started from. I mean.
Right. It's the old country.
Yeah.
Right. So it's, you're right. It's rural. It, again, this is where movies can do this, right? They're giving you the images. They don't have to say, we're on a farm. They show people farming or using a blacksmith or a manual tailor and all. Plucking chickens. Also notice the gender roles of it, right? I mean, and this film was made in 1971. The musical comes out in 64. But most American Jews at that time are not living that lifestyle.
Not Jewish.
They're not living, they're not chasing the chickens, they're not sending their kids to Hebrew school at 3 years old, they're not doing arranged marriages, right, whoever Papa picks. The men aren't in the day, aren't studying in the synagogue all day. The women aren't, you know, obeying whatever, you know, to have the final word at home, that kind of model. That's not how things are working, even in the 60s, certainly not in the 70s. So, you know, the world they're presenting here is a world of tradition, but ironically, it's the tradition that's going to break down, even in the course of the musical, right? They get the sewing machine, the train takes the daughter away, they choose to marry, one of them marries someone not Jewish. Like, you've got all these challenges. Yeah, Leora.
But one of the things I like about it is that it shows Jews in the old country doing non-religious things, being a blacksmith, being a tailor, being a butcher, things that we think about people in the old country, we think of the Shiva Bochos, you know, and this shows the well-roundedness of the community and how they supported each other and they depended upon each other.
Right, it's a sort of imagined self-sufficient community, but there's a broader community around them. I mean, we know that you know, that there's the farmers and the other people in the other part of our village, as he puts it.
Interestingly enough, my father's parents live very much that lifestyle in Pennsylvania.
Right, so it's a generational thing, not even a geography thing. You know, the American population has gotten so much more urban in the last 100 years than anywhere else. So I just find it an interesting example of a Jewish movie, because American Jews would not see them, most American Jews would not see themselves in that film. And in fact, the ones who would be the most likely to see themselves in that film are the ones who are least likely to go to a movie theater, because they're the ultra-Orthodox Jews who are maintaining a lot of the elements of that traditional lifestyle. In fact, when Jerome Robbins, who did the choreography for the Broadway show, wanted to get an authentic Hasidic dance for the wedding scene, he went and visited a lot of ultra-Orthodox Jewish weddings in New York. I think he invented the bottle dance thing, which now people do based on having seen it in there. But he was seeing the kind of dancing that would happen at those kind of weddings when he was choreographing the stage show, because those were the authentic Jews. Robbins himself, his father was a Holocaust survivor. He was Jewish, but very, you know, alienated from it. And there's a very funny episode when they were first staging Fiddler on the Roof on stage. And Zero Mostel, who originated the role of Fiddler, himself had come from an Orthodox background. So they were doing a scene where Tevye gets home, and as he walked in, he touched the doorpost and kissed his hand and walked in. And Robin said, "What are you doing? What is that?" He didn't even know. And Mostel said, "Well, Tevye is a religious man. There'd be a mezuzah on the doorpost that he would always kiss when he walks in." And Robin says, "That's distracting. Don't do that." So they ran the scene again, and again he kissed it and walked in. And Robin said, I forbid you to do that. The audience won't get it. No one will understand." So the next time, Mostel walks in and he goes like this. He makes a cross. And so then I said, "Okay, fine. You can kiss the mezuzah."
Funny. I saw that on Broadway.
Yeah. Now I want to show you the very end of the film, which should be a real downer, right? They've been expelled from their town. The family is scattered. But something a little upbeat about it, and we'll see. What's upbeat about the ending is that the people watching it know that they're the sequel. You know, Tevye is their father, their grandfather, and those Ashkenazi Jews in New York or in Detroit or Chicago or wherever they saw the show, they're the sequel. They're the descendants of that story. So they know there's a happy ending, even though it's a depressing point. And it's what makes it a universal story of leaving home, moving to a new country, you know, the old versus the new, same kind of human dynamics. It's just set in a Jewish key. And that's what I think makes it a particularly Jewish movie, but one that won the Academy Award for Best Picture, not because it was a documentary, you know, because it told a compelling story. So I want to show one other clip of a movie that's sometimes thought of as a Jewish movie, or seen particularly is thought of as a Jewish scene. This is from the Woody Allen film Annie Hall.
It's a nice ham this year, Mom.
Oh, yeah. Grammy always does such a good job.
Great sauce.
It is. It's dynamite ham.
We went over to the swap meet. Annie, Graham, and I. Got some nice picture frames.
We really had a good time.
Ann tells us that you've been seeing a psychiatrist for 15 years.
Yes, I'm making excellent progress. Pretty soon when I lie down on his couch, I won't have to wear the lobster bib.
Dwayne and I went out to the boat basin.
We were caulking holes all day.
And Randolph Hunt was drunk, as usual.
Oh, that Randolph Hunt. You remember Randy Hunt, Annie? He was in the choir with you.
Oh, yes.
I can't believe this family. Annie's mother is really beautiful. And they're talking swap meets and boat basins, and the old lady at the end of the table is a classic Jew hater. And they really look American, you know, very healthy. They're, like, they never get sick or anything. Nothing like my family. You know, the two are like oil and water.
Who needs this business?
His wife has diabetes.
Diabetes?
Jack Adams is the new president.
Diabetes?
Let me tell you.
The man is 50 years old and doesn't have a substantial job.
Is that a reason to steal?
Oh, yes, that's right.
What are you talking about? You know what you're talking about.
Sure, defend him.
Oh, you remember her.
I'm the president.
We're in 4-H.
Oh, Moscow. He had a coronary.
How do you plan to spend the holidays, Mrs. Singer?
We fast.
Fast?
You know, no food. You know, to atone for our sins.
What sins? I don't understand.
Tell you the truth, neither do we.
Okay, so here you've got a contrast in cultural style. You've got the WASP, you know, upstanding or uptight, depending on how you want to read it. And then you've got the Jewish, you know, New York, loud, pushy, crowded, food all over the place. Yelling, talking about people's illnesses. When Alvy Singer, who is the Woody Allen character there, is in this WASP setting, he feels like an ultra-Orthodox Jew, even when he's just talking about being in therapy, right? You saw that imagery there of how he's feeling by the way she looks at him. This in some ways is a more relatable Jewish character than the Tevye version, because this is lived Jewish experience of being in the non-Jewish world, of experiencing, that kind of dynamic. And so in some ways, the Woody Allen style is another style of Jewish movie that's not as sort of insular Jewish focus. It's more focused on Jewish life in the broader world, but also the Jewishness is almost an aside in many of the scenes. It's about his personal dynamic with this woman and how the relationship goes, and the Jewishness isn't always the focus, although he does seem to have this obsession with going to see a documentary film called The Sorrow and the Pity, which is like a 10-hour documentary about the Holocaust, and he keeps wanting to go see it over and over again. And she says, enough, I just can't take this anymore. So that's one of the questions of how you're presenting Jewish characters is, are they overly neurotic, like does it become a caricature rather than a fully developed character? Now, other genres of films we don't have time to get into would include Holocaust-focused films. Think of Schindler's List, but also plenty of others besides that. I remember when Robin Williams was in a Holocaust film called Jacob the Liar. It came out a year or two after Schindler's List. It actually wasn't that great of a film, but people felt guilty reviewing it and saying it wasn't a great film because it's a Holocaust film. What are you supposed to do? Like, how could you say it's not a good film? But in theory, you could make a bad Holocaust film. But you also had the challenge of the Italian film Life is Beautiful, which you might remember with Roberto Benigni, where he plays a Jewish man. He himself is not Jewish, but a Jewish man who manages to help his son survive the Holocaust by making him think it's a hide and seek game. And so he's in a labor camp, but he hides his kid, and the kid has to hide all day because if they find you, then you're not going to win the prize. And he manages to help his son survive through the whole thing. But he's sort of goofing off and clowning through this Holocaust story. And some people felt it was tone deaf, inappropriate, that you shouldn't have. But one can imagine that actually is a very plausible story. I found it very moving, but that was a controversial depiction as well. We're also not talking about European Jewish films or Israeli movies. Obviously, they have a ton to say about Jewish identity in the modern world and Israeliness in the modern world. And there's even the whole genre of documentary films, which often are very explicitly on Jewish themes, be it the Holocaust or on modern Judaism. I will show you a short clip from one of my favorite documentaries. It's called The Tribe, done by Tiffany Schlein. And she does a really interesting job of explaining Judaism in the context of humanity, but it's a great way to introduce her documentary. She also finds a way to work Barbie dolls into it.
Over 6 billion people live on the planet Earth. Thinking of them as a tribe of 100 people, there would be 60 Asians, 14 North and South Americans, 13 Africans, and 12 Europeans. 30 tribe members would be Christian, 18 would be Muslims, 13 Hindus, 6 Buddhists, and 33 would be other faiths, including, of the 100 tribe members, 1/4 of 1 would be Jewish. Within this circle, there was a woman named Ruth who created the Barbie doll. A Jewish woman created Barbie. Maybe Barbie can explain something about how this generation responds to being Jewish today. Since the old days, Jews refer to themselves as members of the tribe. But what does it mean to be a member of a tribe in the 21st century? A tribe is a group of people with something in common. For example, a tribe of hunters, a tribe of gatherers. Tribes can have other things in common, like interests or family. A tribe may have within it a smaller group or subset called sub-tribes. For example, the American tribe includes the sub-tribe of Democrats and the sub-tribe of Republicans, as well as many other sub-tribes. Although sub-tribes may disagree, they remain members of the larger tribe. Within the tribe of girls, there's the sub-tribe who love horses, and the sub-tribe who love Barbie dolls. Even within the tribe of boys, there's a sub-tribe who loves Barbie dolls. There's also a large sub-tribe that doesn't love Barbie dolls. But all sub-tribes can agree, Barbie doesn't look Jewish. Barbie's creator was named Ruth Handler. Barbie's full name is Barbara Millicent Roberts. Not such a Jewish name. Throughout her doll life, Barbie's had hundreds of identities. She's been astronaut Barbie, flight attendant Barbie, presidential candidate Barbie, and wedding Barbie who wears a diamond ring. Diamonds are formed when carbon is subjected to intense pressure over long periods of time. They're also a girl's best friend. Diamonds are often exchanged as part of Western marriage rituals. All tribes have marriage rituals. In the Jewish marriage ritual, the groom breaks a glass. This is symbolic of the fragility of life and in remembrance of the past. The American Jewish tribe has many sub-tribes. They're often arranged in terms of how observant they are. Orthodox, conservative, reform, renewal, unorthodox orthodox, atheist, and many other sub-tribes. Ultra-orthodox, modern orthodox, Hasidic, Reconstructionist, The super Jew, the Kabbalahist, the Catholic who's into Kabbalah, the Jubu, the Julu, and the Hindu. Outside of religion, there are many cultural distinctions between Jews. For example, in New York, everyone seems Jewish. While in California, no one does. All American Jews share some things in common, like culture, heroes, and stereotypes. Too pushy, too greedy, too materialistic, too Jewish American princessy. In America, we don't have princesses. We have celebrities. The glorification of celebrities creates a culture of insiders and outsiders. Throughout history, the Jewish tribe has been treated as outsiders. As a result, Jews feel a special empathy with fellow outsiders. Maybe this also explains why they invented a bread with only an outside. Although Jews are often outsiders, when they meet other Jews, they feel like insiders. One might say the essential Jewish perspective is standing outside and looking in.
To get a flavor of that documentary, it's really interesting. It's only about 30 minutes long, but it's exploring this concept of what it means to be part of the tribe or to be Jewish in different ways. And she does a wonderful job of depicting sort of on an equal plane of these are just lots of different alternatives. They're all sub-tribes within the broader tribe. So it's taking a complicated issue and making it simple. That's part of the goal of a documentary. But there are a lot of others out there. We actually did a discussion at my congregation just a few weeks ago on a Holocaust documentary a man did about his father and his father's experience before the World War. And he actually managed to get out of Germany in August of 1939. So like the last possible minute, right? This is a documentary called Stones from the Soil. It's an interesting story. But there are lots of documentaries on all kinds of Jewish stories. And they're another way to experience Jewish culture without having to, go to a synagogue. And then lastly, we'll touch on television just very briefly, because nothing is as boring as talking about, shows like this. But early in television, David Satloff, I think, was early involved in the development of NBC. Some of the inventors of the technology behind television were Jewish. And then, of course, you've got Sid Caesar, who was a pioneer in his show called Your Show of Shows, which ran in the early 50s, and then the Sid Caesar Show, which followed up on it. Writers on his shows included Mel Brooks, Woody Allen, Neil Simon, and Larry Gelbart, who would later develop MASH. And there was even an early TV show called The Goldbergs, not related to the 1980s one, the one set in the 80s, it's actually out now. But the original Goldberg show was based on a radio show that had a main character, Mrs. Goldberg, who was, a busybody and a yenta, that personality, but it was a very popular radio show. And so when TV came out, they actually cast it and had a TV show for 8 years from 49 to 57. And a lot of these actors on TV came directly from the vaudeville or the so-called Borscht Belt circuit, where they performed at Jewish resorts in the Catskills. Think, Dirty Dancing, that's sort of a classic depiction of that, that kind of resort culture. But they had this style of comedy and they managed to translate it into this new medium of television. Now, Jews in TV were never as dominant a power as they were in Hollywood, simply because others got into the industry as well. But they were very often regular characters in ensemble dramas or ensemble comedies and even important characters, not always the centerpiece, but there are some exceptions to that too. So, for example, I think about the character of Rhoda Morgenstern from the Mary Tyler Moore Show, who got her own spin-off show for 5 years called Rhoda, and she was the core character. She was Jewish. And again, not a Tevye-style Jewish, but a more modern, assimilated, feminist-style Jewish. You had the show The Nanny, which was popular in the 90s, with Fran Drescher, who plays a Jewish character and herself is very Jewish in a very sort of obvious, almost stereotypical way with her accent. Or again, I mentioned the examples of the Gellers on Friends or the character of Howard Wolowitz on The Big Bang Theory, where their Jewishness comes up periodically. Sometimes it comes up to say, wow, look at the Jew eat ham, to point out he's a bad Jew, quote unquote. But he'll reference his bonds from his bar mitzvah or, other kinds of Jewish events that he has to go to. In the end, though, when American Jews are consuming this culture, sort of like with modern literature, they're going to get out of it what they're looking for. You know, so if you want to see a representation of yourself in a character in a sitcom or in a Woody Allen character in a movie, you'll find that resonance with your experience. But if you want something more didactic, you're going to look for a film like A Serious Man by the Coen brothers, which is a retelling of the Job story set around a man dealing with a divorce and his son's bar mitzvah. And again, the Jewishness is permeating the story. Or again, a documentary film or something like that, where the sitcom is going to make the Jewishness a comedy and episodic thing, but not a really deep meditation on identity. The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel, I think, is an interesting, complicated case because it has this mix of Jewish and non-Jewish in it. If it had been done in the 50s, it wouldn't have been a success because it would have been entirely an in-joke. And that's where Mel Brooks sort of straddles the line sometimes, where he has Jewish in-jokes that are aimed at a Jewish or Judaism literate audience, but it also plays to the broader world. You know, I think of the faces on those people at that scene in The Producers when they're doing Springtime for Hitler, and I'm thinking these are all Jewish theatergoers who have bought this tickets and they're watching Hitler dance around and all these Nazi flags and everything, and they're just staring as appalled. It is riotous. Or the other example, and that's what I'm going to play for you now, is a scene during Blazing Saddles where Mel Brooks does put on red face. He dresses up as a Native American, but it's in order for his Native Americans to speak Yiddish. So this is that that famous scene where a African-American family is in a wagon train and they're sort of pulled over by Native Americans.
Schwarzes. No, seid nicht mit Sugar. Los im Gehen! Kappa walk, it's all right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Big is in. Take off. Has big as in deine Leben? They darker than us. Woof!
So, and my mother told me that she went to see this in the theater. You could tell where the Jews were sitting because they were roaring with laughter. And the non-Jewish audience, they did not get it at all. So sometimes this is the complexity of Jewish representation in film, where it's an in-joke that a certain audience gets, and that's part of the complexities of presenting a minority identity in a majority culture. Lior, you were going to say something?
Yeah, I had the opposite experience. I saw it in Israel, in the Cinerama, in 1970, I think, or 71. And you could tell the pockets of Americans because there were certain parts the Americans were dying with laughter and the Israelis were just sitting there silent. So, opposite.
Right. Now, I'm just going to say that, you know, there were a lot of things like the Dick Van Dyke Show, for example, you know, where the characters who were Jewish, you know, sort of introduced a sort of Eastern Jewish culture into TV that I think a lot educated a lot of people over time to sort of get some of these jokes and things.
Right.
Buddy Hackett and people like this. You know.
Lenny Bruce has a whole, he had a whole shtick on what's Jewish and what's Goyish, and
yeah.
Lime Jello is not Jewish, and corned beef is Jewish, and so
I mean, but I mean, I think that the TV introduced a lot of people to that kind of culture, and they begin to get something.
Right.
And it worked its way into the culture so much that today, when you listen to the news, you hear, I heard somebody say, the White House has no chutzpah last week.
No.
I mean, all these words from Yiddish have worked their way maybe into New York English.
Certainly New York, yeah.
Yeah, where these commentators come from, but into the general lexicon.
But there's a significant number of Yiddish words sort of as general New York language, I think, that everybody
yeah.
says, you know.
But it's right. I mean, even the Germans use the word kosher all the time.
Yeah, this isn't kosher. I mean, it's a,
yeah.
Right. Right. So can you think of other examples of movies that you found as particularly Jewish, or TV shows or plays that you've seen? Yeah, Leora.
Well, my two favorite movies are The Tribe, which I used to use in class. And the other one is The Frisco Kid. And I love The Frisco Kid. which is about Gene Wilder plays a Shmendrick rabbi from Poland. He's in the bottom of his class, and the board gets a letter that a rabbi is required in San Francisco. And they don't know from San Francisco. All they know is New York. And so they decide to send this guy, this know-nothing guy, rabbi, to America. And he lands in America, and it's his adventures. He gets taken advantage of, and he ends up hooking up with a bank robber, who's played by Harrison Ford, a very young Harrison Ford. And there's one point where they're running away from the sheriff, I guess. They've he's robbed a bank, the bank robber, and they're running away, and it's Shabbat. And the rabbi says, I don't ride on Shabbat, I walk. And the guys are getting closer and closer. It's the next day, it's getting to be sunset. They're chasing him. He's like, Rabbi, we gotta go, we gotta go, we gotta get on the horses to go. And Gene Wilder, there's this big rock, and he goes like this until you can barely see the sun over the rock. You know, it looks like it's setting, and he says, okay, we go. And it's just viewed with this, with all of these. He ends up with an Amish family, and he walks up and he goes, Landsman, Landsman, you know, because he hears them speaking something that sounds like Yiddish. It's a wonderful movie, a silly movie, but a wonderful movie. And it shows how Hollywood depicted, gave America Jews in a certain sense. I think it's a great movie.
I wanted to say one thing that was, and I mentioned to you this last week, but I've always thought that sometimes because an actor, in a sense, creates a Jewish sort of aurora around the character. So here you have a movie called A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum, which is not anything Jewish, but Tzoulis, you know, Zero Mostel is so Jewish in everything he does, in a way, almost stereotypical, that you can't help thinking of it as, you know, the way he's... I mean, it's to producers in the Roman Empire. I mean, right. In a sense.
And it was written by Larry, or I think produced by Larry Gelbart again, one of the early writers on Sid Caesar's short shows.
But at the same time, then you have, you know, Jewish producers creating Casablanca, which doesn't have any, you know, not remotely, you know, except for the refugee issue, sort of. But there's nothing Jewish at all about that movie.
Right.
I don't know. There's lots of Jewish ethics in that movie.
Well, but, and see, this is the problem with a movie like that, where you've got Jewish writers, and it's set during World War II, it's made during World War II, so you're thinking, well, there's got to be a lot of Jewish subtext here, but you wind up playing like ethnic detective or cultural detective. What's Jewish about this scene, or what's Jewish about this dialogue? And I don't know, I find that becomes not the same Hebrew lahavdil, make a distinction, but the Nazis did that. You know, they wanted to find the Jewish subtext in Einstein's relativity and the Jewish subtext in Freud's psychology, and they're playing ethnic detective too. And I don't know. And some of those ethics, you know, ethics that are Jewish are also universal. That is, an ethic that says love the stranger is not only Jewish. You know, there are passages in lots of cultures that present that. And if a Christian is quoting it, they're quoting Jesus quoting it. They're not quoting Leviticus quoting it. So. It's hard to claim that this ethic is particularly Jewish, unless you have, you know, a letter from the screenwriter who said, I remember a lesson in Hebrew school about how, you know, if you want to be brought back in time, you ask someone to play an old song for you, and so then I wrote that scene where he says, play it again, Sam, and that's why it says that. Well, okay, you know, if you've got documentary evidence like that, okay, but again, I wouldn't, you know, play a mega detective. And then, honestly, there's a lot of Jewish-focused material in movies, theater, television, etc. You don't have to necessarily mine the depths to find the hidden sparks of Jewishness in every piece. That's my perspective.
It's not specific to any of the movies that we saw here tonight, but just in general, I find on in so many movies and certain TV shows, the Jewish characters are done in such stereotypes that it upsets me. And in fact, in almost every time I've seen a rabbi, you know, an actor as a rabbi in movies, and that they're always, you know, I can't say always, but it seems like 90% of the time, they're old, they have these enormous beards, and it's just like...
Or they're clowns. I mean, they're played for laughs.
Yeah, that's true.
It just bothers me because it's just not that realistic. And I always, and I think to myself, well, people who are not Jewish and watching this, it just keeps enforcing these stereotypes. Or women who are very, you know, loud and big mouths and nosy and all of like the actress who did Seinfeld's mother, or in Rhoda, the one who played her mother. You know, those kinds of things bother me when I see it.
So here's an article from 1998. Critics call show self-hating. Was Seinfeld good for the Jews? This is from the San Francisco area Jewish newspaper. Considering how many of the Seinfeld writers are Jewish, more than half the team at least, it's no surprise the show would be rife with jokes about parents in Florida, girlfriends if you kosher, Jewish single defense, even Nazis, like the soup Nazi. After a top Jewish television executive dismissed the original pilot as too Jewish, they gave him a second chance later, and now it's, you know, coming up to the finale, which happened in 1998. It's obviously their quirky witticisms and oddball idiosyncrasies are not too Jewish for America, but was it good for the Jews? So in the Washington Post, he declared it was not too Jewish, but too self-hatingly Jewish. So think of the episodes that actually deal with Judaism. You've got Elaine getting counseling from a rabbi who divulges her secrets on television, a neighborhood soup stand proprietor is called the soup Nazi, the moil she finds for a friend's child circumcision mistakenly cuts Jerry's finger instead, Newman catches Jerry and his girlfriend making out during Schindler's List, that's a big scandal. In the episode entitled Schick's Appeal, Elaine discovers that Jewish men like her because she's not Jewish. So a couple of rabbis described that it's not funny when it deals with Jewish issues. It pokes fun, but it's stereotypical and offensive. They feel it's blatantly hostile toward Judaism. It has unfortunate stereotypes about clergy, rituals, and women, instead of offering honest and positive depictions. Like they're a propaganda. I mean, what do they want a sitcom to do? Offer honest and positive depictions of ethnic groups? That's not what they do, but that's the critique. But Abraham Foxman, who directed the Anti-Defamation League, says she's missing the point. Getting positive messages about Judaism is not what the show is about. It's a comedy. He did have an issue with the soup Nazi because it trivializes the Holocaust. And he didn't like the one about the rabbi who betrays Elaine. But generally, he says the Jewishness of the Seinfeld characters was worn comfortably and naturally on their sleeves. There were no bizarre or eccentric Jews. Seinfeld is human, universal. They're no more stereotyped than any other minority. And Jews are among some of the show's biggest fans. Rabbi Harold Schulweis, a major rabbi in Southern California, said the Jews have arrived. We no longer worry about what the anti-Semites will say. It does mean we've somewhat lost our uniqueness. There's a lack of purpose and spirituality in American Jewish life, and maybe Seinfeld reflects that. And Marshall Waldeck puts it in the context of the history of Jewish humor and Jewish style humor. So what he calls Jewish humor came out of the cultural unease after the birth of the Enlightenment. This resulted from the modern European-oriented Jews making fun of their country bumpkin cousins of the shtetl and Hasidic rabbis. So when Seinfeld does that, it's in part of that tradition. But Jewish style humor is the tension between Jewish comedy and American culture in the early 20th century, balancing between the old world and the new. But the comedians were afraid of negative reaction, de-Judaized their subjects. So vaudeville comics, the Marx Brothers, also of Jewish background, where they don't talk explicitly about Jewishness, but they're drawing on these personalities that they've experienced. Seinfeld is part of these traditions. It's also altered them. Jerry Seinfeld did not change his name, unlike Woody Allen or George Burns or those earlier actors. He maintained his Jewishness, and the line between him and his character is almost non-existent. Jason Alexander did change his name, but he's actually even more Jewishly engaged than Seinfeld at times. He's done public speaking for the Anti-Defamation League, and he actually walked off the taping of an episode of Gary Shandling's cable show where they had a simulated game show involving Adolf Hitler, and Alexander said, forget it. Soup Nazi is one thing. This is a bridge too far. So this question of, is how Jews are portrayed in movies and TV good for the Jews? It's an old one. It's going to be one going forward. Fortunately, we don't have boycotts like Bridget and Bernie in the early 70s, but we also have a massive fragmentation of the Jewish audience. You know, there are Jewish cable channels that you can watch. There are shows that cater to more Orthodox populations. You can get Israeli satellite television, and a lot of Israeli shows have made it to Netflix. There's a show called Fauda, for example, which is about the Israeli's Mossad Secret Service and spies embedded in Palestinian communities. That's a major Netflix hit, just with subtitles. So the lines between the genres are sometimes bending, but also it's fragmenting the audience. So when Sid Caesar was putting on your show of shows, there were two channels or three channels, and that's what you watch. Nowadays, defining what is common Jewish popular culture, common Jewish television, I've never seen one episode of The Goldbergs, even though it's framed as a Jewish show. And I'll be honest, as a rabbi, I find watching Jewish movies to feel like work. It's not, I'm not relaxed. There was a good movie with an interesting portrayal of a rabbi called Keeping the Faith with Ben Stiller, where there are three people. There's a young girl and two boys that are all friends. And as they grow up, one of the men becomes a priest and one becomes a rabbi. And the girl is sort of torn in between two of them, and they're torn with her and whatever. But the presentation of the rabbi's role there actually is nuanced and realistic and human and not a character and not a clown. And I put up watching it because it felt like work, but in the long run, I'm glad I saw it. So there are other films with Jewish themes that I haven't seen because they felt like work, but I think in the long run, if people watch them and they feel a Jewish connection, I know a lot of Jewish people who watch The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel and do not feel offended and feel really, they really connect with the story and the characters, then who am I to judge? All right. Well, thanks for taking this journey through Jewish performance culture. In 2 weeks, we'll be back and we'll talk about Jewish music and Jewish art as going even further beyond the verbal written form into either sung or melodic expression or even visual art and that expression of Jewishness.
That's 2 weeks.
In 2 weeks. Yeah.